Hi, my name is Sandra, and I want to welcome you to this video to help you make your garden more accessible. There's no one-size-fits-all to accessible gardening, so you will find out through this video that no two people nor two gardens are the same.
Let me introduce you to Leo, Suzanne, Susie, and Teresa. Their stories, along with my own, are interwoven in this video. We considered our physical access needs as we embraced our love of gardening. Please join us through this video to learn some tips and celebrate the practice of accessible gardening. Our participants told us how their gardens changed over multiple seasons as their gardening goals changed and their needs changed as well. Whether you live in a single family home or in a community setting, it's advisable to start small with your accessible garden. Build on your successes and learn from your early attempts before investing in costly or permanent changes. No matter why you need to adapt your garden for accessibility, one common consideration is time. Whether it takes you longer to get from A to B, your hands tire, or you have limited range of motion, or you have difficulty taking on a complex task in the garden. All of these things mean you need extra time to get things done. Thus, an accessible garden is one that makes efficient use of your time. When planning or modifying your garden, be patient with yourself and conserve your energy, reduce wear and tear on your body, and keep things to a manageable pace. Gardening is a journey. Many of the best practices for gardening outlined in the Growing Together video series align perfectly with accessible gardening. We live in a moderate zone 8B, which gives us access to our gardens 12 months a year. Everything grows in abundance, so an accessible garden needs to provide access to plant, maintain, and prune year-round. We are also dealing with issues such as drought and temperature extremes. So be sure to look through the CRD videos on container gardening, urban gardening, composting and mulching, and other topics to save you energy, time, and resources to help your accessible garden thrive. The City of Victoria and the Public Health Association of BC's Can You Dig It program created a community garden accessibility toolkit that provides examples of universal design principles and offers an easy-to-use guide for garden coordinators to ensure their community gardens are accessible to everyone in their respective communities. You'll find a link to this toolkit at the end of this video. Tips from our participants that made their gardens more accessible include many gardening best practices, such as square foot gardening, container gardening, including self-watering containers, raised beds, drip irrigation, vertical gardening, growing sprouts and microgreens, no-till gardening, composting, mulching, and vermicomposting. Their gardens are full of color, fragrance, and the sounds of birds and bees. These sensory experiences greatly enhance enjoyment of a garden, which is so important to keep us motivated to spend time in our accessible gardens.
Let's hear Suzanne describe her garden and how she made it work for her.
I think the easiest thing for me to do is container gardening. And having a raised bed back there in the summer where I can plant vegetables will make a big difference. In the winter, there's not much happening in the garden anyway, so it's not a big loss that I can't come back here. But in the summer, when you can grow a lot of things, like this is ideal, of course, here, this surface to work on and to have as many container plants as possible. And then to have the blueberry bushes so accessible for picking is nice. Even this plant here, I can pick all the fruit that's hanging. This is a good structure to have because without it, you know, this wouldn't work if I didn't have this nice structure holding it up. So, and I'm lucky because I have a lot of upper body strength, and because I can carry things and move, I carry dirt around, I move pots around, I can bend over, I can do all the weeding that's accessible to me. So the only thing is I can't stand up to shovel things into the ground. That's where I get help to do things. Also, actually, having somebody else to garden with is kind of fun. Like to do it with somebody else, to bounce off ideas, because sometimes you don't know what you want to do, and then you just have somebody to talk to about it. And gardening is a solitary sport. It's not a sport, but a solitary activity most of the time. But to be able to do it with somebody else is nice. Yeah. And I've been getting assistance for 20 years in the summer, and I started off by getting people off the U of IC job board, the casual job board, getting students that way. But there aren't as many students on there anymore, so now I just go to like U Victoria, that's the main place where I'm going. But yeah, so it's usually been every year it's been students that I've had help me, and so it's just really they're my legs.
Whether it's to allow smooth rolling of a walker or wheelchair, to prevent someone who uses a cane who has trouble seeing the evenness of the ground from tripping, or just to make rolling a wheelbarrow or moving tubs easier, the foundation of any accessible garden begins with pathways. Aesthetics aside, most would agree that grass does not make a reliable year-round surface. Several of our participants mentioned that access on grass was only available to them during the drier months. Anything other than paved surfaces presents challenges. Bark mulch and gravel, if laid too deeply, drain well but are not easy for either wheels or persons with balance concerns. Heavy rubber mats may be a workaround to firm up the path. Flagstones and some pavers may also be difficult because of their uneven surfaces and spacing. In my garden, we used fine gravel on a slope surface and applied a BC-made path stabilization material underneath the slope to keep the gravel in place. This gives my mobility scooter a firm surface despite the slope year-round. This honeycombed grid can be used for grass and other surfaces and is made from recycled materials here on Vancouver Island. Elevating plants so they are at a convenient height makes planting and maintaining them easier. If planning for specific individuals, consider their ability to approach and reach into the garden, to use one or two hands, and to lift. Raised beds take a lot of soil, and replenishing and top dressing the garden bed throughout the year is heavy work.
If you have difficulty lifting, and especially if you don't have regular help, container gardening may be the way to go.
They are easier to maintain year-round and give the added benefit of putting them in places with safe and convenient access. Self-watering containers have reservoirs to minimize watering demands. Similarly, vertical gardens use stacked containers to minimize maintenance and maximize plant production. Experiment to find the height and weight of containers that best suits your needs. Container gardening is diverse and adaptable. It can be as lightweight as indoor sprouts and microgreens, or as heavy as half barrels sitting on your balcony or patio. Plant selection also makes a difference to accessibility. Grow one-time harvest crops, like Brussels sprouts and leeks, in less accessible locations, and higher maintenance and cut and come again crops, like kale, lettuce, and basil, in areas with best access. Square foot gardening is an efficient way to plan crop accessibility in your garden. It works for both raised beds and container gardens. If you're designing a garden for community housing, like where Leo and Teresa live, look to universal design principles for guidance. Both Teresa and Leo mentioned how community members share gardening knowledge and tasks. This division of labor is a good fit for people with accessibility concerns. Sitting while gardening is important to be safe and conserve energy. If you only need occasional access to a seat, you can find rolling garden seats and kneeler benches to give you easily portable seating solutions. A sturdy wooden or concrete block planter may include a wide edge for sitting. Similarly, an elevated garden bed or shelf may help someone sitting in a chair or a wheelchair approach the garden to reach plants without excessive bending. Teresa's garden at Spackenhaus, in addition to many accessible raised beds, also has a meditation area. This contains therapeutic and medicinal plants and plants of cultural significance to Indigenous people, like sage, golden seal, and tobacco. Teresa also shared with us that through gardening, she is able to pass on this knowledge to the next generation.
I think it's really, really good the way it is. I can use my walker or my wheelchair out here with no problem. Just slide in close and start pulling weeds. I have never seen anything like it. And especially being supportive housing, it's great. And I can get to any of them pretty much. And when I get some more mobility back, then I can start helping in the lower gardens. I decide I can access. And I think it's a really good start design for other places. The planter boxes, they're there forever. Mm-hmm. And seasonal planting and everything, it's great. More people should get into gardening. Learning about our medicinal plants as well, not just the vegetables. Mm-hmm. That's very important. Nikki's done a very good job at trying to help us relearn what's important, you know, that we need to learn from our elders, because it's just so much that's been lost. Because I have to admit, I didn't really know a lot about the medicinal plants and that end, because I just did vegetables and berries. So. It's been a really good learning experience, and I can now, what I learned here, I can pass it on to my 15-year-old, and try and teach him as much as I can about his culture.
Let's now listen to Leo describe the division of labor and community-mindedness that brings both gardeners and non-gardeners together in his complex.
We share with they share with other community members a camp garden. So they make a list. You want fresh veggies? She's got a list. We harvest all this stuff, split it up, and deliver to the people camp the garden. We had one person that had issues with the gardening, but he's got some help to come in and help me. I do too. I got vertigo, so I can't look up. Mm-hmm. So I get someone to come in and help me do what needs to be done, and then tell them go. Everybody tries to do as much as they can, but sometimes you can't do it. Mm-hmm. So that's when you go to the front office and say, can you help me? And they'll hook them up with, you know, somebody that can help. Mm-hmm. Usually. I started 5 years ago. So there's people who know way more about plants. Even gardening for long. Mm. On YouTube myself. So. But that's a good thing about the community. Is that, say, like, I'll ask Asker. What's this thing? You know, or ask this guy here, vigorous. And he'll say, well, you plant these at this time of year, this. So everybody helps you, other people, right? That's nice.
What accessibility means to you?
What it means to me is access to this. Now, like I said, sitting on these things is just perfect. Because the lady over there, she can barely walk. But she can still garden because of that.
Thank you for watching this video. No matter if you are designing an accessible garden for yourself or for others, I hope we have given you some ideas and inspiration from our perspectives and experiences. We encourage you to embrace your shared passion with those around you and draw upon each other's strengths and unique abilities to bring your accessible garden to life. This is truly growing together.